I did this already?
Hello.
Hey, morning, Clemens. Give me one sec. I'm still having double sound problems. Can you speak real quick?
Yes, I'm speaking, I'm saying things, I'm making sounds.
Got it. How do I turn this on? Okay, put that one down. Yeah. Okay, speak again.
Hello.
Excellent.
I'm making sounds. Great.
Excellent. I think we got it. Great. Yeah, so I was looking over what you sent earlier. So ultimately, how are you feeling about this PT? I mean, a 172 raw is still pretty darn strong.
Mm.
Yeah. And like you said, like those two LG questions definitely should have been correct. You know, like you absolutely had the ability to get them right. So we're getting there. How do you feel?
I think like my long-term consistency is improving. In the past, I sometimes had results that were like in the high 70s, but then also had like some that were in the 60s. And now I'm more in the middle ground, like in the low 70s, which is, I think, good. Like it's more predictable.
Yeah.
But I think it sounds silly to talk about this, but at this point, some of these really simple and seemingly trivial things make a really big difference. Like,
yeah.
How attentively do you read a given paragraph? And I noticed that looking back at the mistakes that I made, a lot of them are not because something is difficult, but rather because of lingering imperfections in how I read and process informations, like maybe focus issues or inattentiveness issues. I did this last week. We spoke about this immediate answer journal that he recommended.
Yeah.
And for half of the things that I did wrong, I wrote down, read more carefully, be more attentive.
Yeah, you could tell what was going wrong as it was happening or what felt difficult about it.
Yeah, there were like two logical reasoning things that really like required some sort of reflection. This one a little bit about formal logic that I wrote down in the Discord, and then this other one about supply and demand. But I think for almost all of them, the main issue was not being able to process information with maximum accuracy under time pressure. So I think yeah, you mentioned, for example, that you read all of these answers and questions multiple times and you constantly cross-check. And maybe that's something that I should be working on. I do a lot of highlighting, for example, and reading comprehension, what typically also works.
Yeah.
But I think I make a lot of accuracy issues, or I don't know, maybe my short-term memory is deficient or...
Well, it's easy as you're moving through an exam, right? For that diligence to slip. Oh, question, when was the logic game section, like in terms of section order? Was that towards the end or towards the beginning?
I think it was 3, but let me look.
Okay.
3.
Yeah, 3 so, RC misses when you got the last one right, but then you switched it. On your blind review, 2 LRs early, 2 games, and then 3 more LR at the end. Okay, that's not as strong as a pattern as I may have been expecting, right? In terms of like fatigue setting in and then your like habits starting to slip.
Mm.
But I mean, you're absolutely right in the fact that, like, you can tell that that's some of the issue, just given on how you understand your own strengths and weaknesses and how you move through these. The one that definitely stood out to me was that 76 section 4 question 14. Those who took 5 minutes on that essay. I think you know
that. Right, so I had, like, I noticed that it's a weird question, and then I, like, when you do the exam online, you can highlight or flag a question and then just get back to it after you answered all the other ones.
Okay.
And then, yeah, so I saved this until the end of the section, and I couldn't get my head around it.
Okay.
Yeah, like, I wrote this lengthy little essay on it. There's a conditional, it's about formal logic, it's not about the content.
Yeah.
But, I think this was a question that was genuinely difficult. The other ones were more slip-ups. And I think the thing to focus on where it's still easiest to improve are these questions that I get wrong because I don't read attentively enough.
We could definitely look over the substance of that one. Because that one actually, when I read it, I was like, I know exactly what I'm looking for. And then I found it in B. The other one I left open at the end is B. If you're looking at, like, the Twitch Studio screen, you'll be able to see that. So I was between B and D, but I, like, once I read B, I felt very strongly about it. We can also talk about it in the context of, like, that argument features thing I showed you. That ending where it becomes a requirement, that's kind of like where things stuck for me, right? This last thing that makes it very clear that, like, this is a requirement. We need at least one of the images on the banknote to be very difficult or impossible to measure accurately. Right. And so, like, the introduction of the word image in this context, right? Right. Images printed on the bank, genuine banknotes, right? I knew that I was looking for something, again, tied to, like, images, and then ties us back into this first sentence, right? Mm-hmm. About, I don't know, accurately measuring the images.
Yeah. And also just has this conditional form. And I think if I had just paid attention to to the logical structure of this, it would have been way easier to solve this than by trying to make sense of the content.
Yeah, makes sense. Agreed. Yeah, especially with your method for working conditionals, because you're very good at sort of diagramming those out in the way that you do. So I think that would have been a good approach. Okay. Yeah, 14 is definitely an interesting one, though. It feels like a lot of hard to connect words. So you chose D. Why did you eliminate B originally? Do you have that in your, at the time notes?
No, I just couldn't make sense of it.
Okay. Yeah, I think if you'd done a full conditional statement here, that would have worked. But ultimately, right, it's like these methods involve making accurate measurements. Therefore, we need to make the images impossible or very different to measure accurately in order to prevent the production of banknotes, right? So we need something that ties back this requirement. We need to make them difficult and impossible to this earlier piece about making accurate measurements. Yeah. And so, like, that leads us to, I think, this conclusion that once the images are measured accurately, there's really no impediment to the banknote being replicated, right? Because we're trying to hinge everything, or the author wants to hinge everything on one single, like, countermeasure, right? And making them difficult or impossible. Yeah. That's the other part. Go ahead, sorry.
I think this is a question where it actually would have made sense to take notes or to visualize that on my paper. And I just looked back at my notes from the exam, and I don't think I wrote anything down for this. I think once you have the elements of the structure visually in front of you, it becomes much easier to make sense of this.
Yeah. Yeah, if you don't mind, real quick, I want to do a quick run through on this. It's not finished, but I'd love to apply it to a few more questions. Right, so,
You have these lists with things that you're looking out for, or
these are all of the sort of categories that exist in my head for conclusion and argument features in logical reasoning questions, and to some degree in reading comp too. Right, so you have like conclusion features, like definitive, right? This is definitely true, right? Probabilistic, where they assign an actual probability. Hedging would be like more likely, highly likely, probably, etc. Contingencies, right, are where they insert a contingent requirement into the conclusion sentence itself. So, like, if blah, blah, blah holds true, then blah, 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 right? They're introducing a contingency for the conclusion. Sequencing, like what happened, but like something happened before another thing, right? We're talking about like an order in time. Off is like more amorphous to explain, right? But it's basically the idea that like if we do this thing, this other thing happens. If we don't do this thing, then the other thing doesn't happen at all, right? On off switch. And then requirement, right? That's just the like the idea that the conclusion is expressing a requirement for another outcome. So to some degree, like these two are leading to taken together could be a formal logic conclusion, an if-then conclusion. But you can see both of those features outside of if-then conclusions as well. Right.
Do you have a complete list of these categories somewhere? Because right now I just see these two images that you sent me.
Oh, I thought I was showing you the one on screen. It is, however, not that much bigger than the one on screen. I need to just write out explanations. I went through about like 60 questions yesterday, just reading the, not answering them, but just reading them and trying to identify all of these things. Right? So most of the argument features, I'm still working on the factual feature descriptions. But the idea is that if you work through these things piece by piece, you kind of just like it's this is the reason I kind of know exactly what answer I'm looking for from the get-go. Like 9122 is a perfect example. There's two correlations in each of the first two sentence factual sentences, and then they make a definitive if-then conclusion, right? And there's no way you get two correlations can be put together to create an if-then conclusion, right? And this was a necessary assumption or a sufficient assumption, one or the other. Right, and I knew I needed something that made these correlations into a clear if then, right? That gap has to be fixed.
A bridge. A bridge.
Yeah, exactly. I know where the bridge needs to be just by looking at like the features of the argument. Yeah. And so that's what I'm kind of doing now is trying to go through questions bit by bit. I'll probably spend like an hour or two later today on this as well, depending on how my afternoon turns out. I don't know. I think it's not the same thing as what Dragon has, right? His is more about like flaw types or specific question types. I think to some degree the early chapters cover a lot of these things, but I don't think there's something like this. And I do think like that's a useful way to break down prompts, right? Because you just see how the structural features fit together. Yeah, it's kind of like the same thing as the reading comp exercises, but applied to logical reasoning instead.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting.
Yeah. Let's just look at this one real quick. If-thens are usually like not that super interesting, especially because this only involves two sentences, but we only have to break it down. Right? This is interesting involve, right? But like involve is like not a hedged involve. So I would say it's like all of these methods, all of these certain methods involve making accurate requirements. So I think that's still an if then. Well, that's the problem with like sufficient and necessary ones. We're just going to get to
Yeah,
number two. It's also going to be if then.
Yeah, I was going with a certain. Like I took the certain to indicate that it's just a subset of these methods. So, it depends.
Yeah, okay. If then arguments are not really, it's not really helpful to like break them down as much, because what matters is like connecting the actual terms, and this is all about structure. So here it's just going to say if then, right? And let's say maybe three. Conclusion, I would say this is a contingent conclusion. All if-then statements are contingent, obviously, just by definition. Contingent, negative, right? To prevent is to be prevented. We're trying to stop something, so I would say that's a negative conclusion. Yeah, that's it. All right, this one's not great for that, but hopefully we'll have something else. So what, why is this doing that? Why can't I get out of the? Sorry, I'm gonna ignore this because it's stupid. Okay, there we go. Okay, what is your feeling on what we should move to next for today? Should we keep focusing on error prevention and LG? Did you said you wanted to dive in and sort of see how I would do things differently? Or how I do my like reread strategy.
Yeah. Can we get at the most simple and most elemental mechanics of reading a question? I think it's something that it's basically so simple that I typically don't even think about it. But I think at this point it makes sense to to just question these most basic automatisms and then see how could I make them more efficient.
Okay. Give me a test that you've done that's higher up. You don't mind me using those questions from?
Sure. So a higher level test number?
Yeah. If it's between like 50 and 75, there's like a really good chance I've seen it before. If it's above 75, I may not have seen it at all. If it's below 40, only if a student brought it up would I be teaching those ones or doing them really.
we can do from one from the 90s, which would be most recent.
Okay.
Like 93, it's just the newest one.
Okay. Where is our LR? We have two LRs. Perfect. 90 minutes. Make sure it doesn't pop out. And let me switch screens for you so you can see the other one. There we go. Okay, so you can see my other one now, the Adept LR screen?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just going to choose a random question.
Can we do section 2, question 25?
25? Wait.
Yeah.
This only has 24? Or is it just
I think this is consent forms? Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I have not seen this one. Perfect.
Yeah, I think it's just two sentences, but they're super long. And then.
Okay, so it's a flaw argument.
Yeah.
Okay, consent forms. Almost all. Out. Resentment or resentment effective. Well, I mean, just because they accept the risk doesn't mean they don't resent something. Like, there's a major like shift in meaning here, right? Like, you can definitely like sign a contract and then later on regret the shit out of it or resent the way things played out or what it actually allowed the other party to do. So, like, that's the immediate flaw I'm looking for. The other thing I'm just trying to focus on is, right, this cast out, right, that's a definitive statement, right? Not this cast a little doubt, just this cast out, and it definitely does cast out. Okay, I think that disconnect is the number one thing I'm seeing. Is there any other major flaws? I don't see another major flaw off the top of my head, so I'm going to start working my answer choices now. But yeah, in terms of what I did here, right, it was the read-through, right, and then the comparison, right, when it first says like this, the accepting the risk versus resenting something, right? Like one is an action, one is a feeling. And you know, your actions can definitely contradict your feelings internally. Especially if like you think it's the logical course to behave or to do, even if you don't want to do it. Okay. Yeah,
And even
this is
before that, you looked at the question stamps. You identified, what am I looking for? Then you turned to the stimulus. Then you read it, and only then did you actually highlight something.
Yeah, well, and I think it's like one of the reasons I think it's critically important to read stems is the stem is telling me that the argument is flawed, right? I know going in and looking at it that there is a flaw that I should at least be able to spot or be in the general vicinity of, right? Whereas if you like read it not knowing there's a flaw, right? It's like much more difficult to spot the flaw. You usually have to reread it again because it wasn't the thing you were looking for in the first time. So yeah, I
And
always read
how?
my stems.
Yeah.
Always. Okay.
How often did you read the stimulus now? Just by going through this, did you read it once, or did you read it like multiple times already at this point?
I read it when I started, and I did this analysis, and then I reread it again, in preparation for answering the question. Right, it's just a quick double check to make sure I'm still thinking about the right question type. Like on errors, like that's not as needed, but on like strength and weaken, right? Especially if it's like you do a strength and you do weaken, you do another strength, and your brain starts to get like, you know, like confused about which one's going on. So the double reread helps a lot, I think.
And
Okay.
this particular stimulus also has like these very long phrasings. It's only two sentences, but they're quite convoluted grammatically. How do
Yeah.
you keep track of the content? So you have these. I know we have all of these relative phrases. We have the diseases from which they are suffering, and then that adds a further qualification.
So I think you could just delete everything from here, right? Consent forms filled out by subjects show that almost all subjects accept the risk of receiving ineffective substances. Those two lines in between are just surplusage. They're not adding anything meaningful. But once you finish the paragraph, you realize that that is not any meaningful content there. Yeah. Whereas like the back half of this is kind of a full necessity, right? But you could also maybe just be like resent being given placebos or resent being given medications, like. Again, like this is surplusage. It's not like critical to the actual logic and argument being made. So consent forms for other subjects show almost all subjects accept the risk of receiving ineffective substances. This casts doubt on the claim made by some ethical ethicists that subjects resent being given placebos or resent being given medicine that turns out to be effective. Right? I would say like the orange part is detail and meta commentary, right? Like the two asides, the two parentheticals, and the last two, that's meta commentary, right? And the other part is just unnecessary detail. And generally on the LSAT, you can always discard the meta commentary and the unnecessary detail. The detail is harder to decide upon, like what is unnecessary versus necessary. I think that comes for a feel. And also, it's like one of those things where, like, right? So I worked for a judge as a clerk. A lot of firms write puffery all the time, right? They add a lot of meaningless semantic content in that doesn't relate to the logic or the argument. And so one of the things like judges get really good at is like just ignoring the stuff that can be ignored, right? Like I'm not going to read the next 30 words because none of it has anything to do with the substance of this. Right. So, but it's a trainable skill, I guess, is what I'm saying, like spotting the meaningful substance, the unnecessary stuff.
Yeah, I think a lot of the questions that I listed, the mistakes that I made was treating something that's actually relevant as just fluff. For example, one question had this info that hammers are particularly close to the entrance now. And then.
Oh, yes, I looked at that one.
Or it's only in this year that the family income is average. And I think what I did wrong is to overlook this information that actually is necessary to answer as something that is like merely a detail or something that gets thrown in on the side, but that actually is not relevant for the argument.
Yeah. The one I actually like that. Oh, sorry, go ahead. My fault.
Yeah, like I've been watching out for harder factors, like is it a quantifier? Is there an indicator of conditional language? So I've been highlighting everything that involves, for example, some or all statements or if then.
Okay.
Yeah, so more these, maybe a little bit more mechanical. And I think that this maybe caused me to overlook some of these information that you mentioned, for example, fact versus feeling or.
Sometimes quantifiers are just misleading. Like here, as I read it, I was like, this doesn't matter. Right?
Yeah.
This doesn't matter either. Right? Like, even though it might be relevant to the bounds of the argument, it's not part of anything flawed in the argument, right? Right, so this says almost all, this says many, those two numbers aren't compatible, right?
Right.
That's the only like quantifier match that I needed to like double check.
Right. So
like,
at this
if this
point,
had said all test subjects, that would be a second flaw, because that says almost all, right?
Yeah, and many is indeterminate.
Yeah.
So at this point, you started by looking at the question stem, identified that it's a flaw, went through the stimulus once, and then reflected upon the stimulus in anticipation of the flaw that you're looking for, possibly with some highlighting with respect to the fact-feeling distinction, but not quantifiers or conditional indicators.
Yeah. I could just, as I read through it, I was keeping in my head, like, do these quantifiers matter at all? By the end of the piece, that paragraph, I was like, no, they don't matter. So I'm not going to, like, emphasize them in my thought process.
And okay. You didn't have any difficulties with the grammatical structure, say, of the first sentence?
Oh, with it's all awful. It's terrible. Oh. This is ridiculous. There should be commas, and this should probably be broken into two sentences.
Yeah.
God, that is a long sentence.
But you didn't read this multiple times. You just read it once, it seems.
The only part I reread, right, was just like the accepting, like basically from here on. Mm. Right? Like as I saw the accept the risk on my first read through, I saw the resent. Right? And resent. Mm. And I just like that was the part I double reread. To just be like, accept the risk versus resent. Those are two very different like states of being or actions.
Mm.
Yeah. So I do like maybe limited reread, and the more confused I am, like if I couldn't find a flaw immediately, what I would probably do is do one answer choice and then go back and try to clarify it again, right? Seeing if like one of the answer choices springboards my brain into recognizing the features better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What happens next? You go through these answer choices from in the reverse order because you think that the LSAT is trying to confuse you and this allows you to avoid this confusion?
Yeah, I think the LSAT screws with you in the ADE order. And I also don't want to for my eyes to glance down while I'm thinking about the first argument. Right, like I want to be focused on one answer at a time. I don't want to start comparing A and B when I haven't gone through CD. Right, doing a comparison between two answer choices before you've eliminated three is just kind of like not useful, or it's an ineffective use of time. And then the other thing is, right, I'm only focused on knocking out wrong answers. I'm looking for flaws. I'm looking for what makes the answer choice flawed. I'm never looking for what makes an answer choice correct, because the thing that makes an answer choice correct is having zero flaws, right? Yeah, I think that's like a very fundamental part of my thought process. It's all about like the negative, what can or cannot happen, and focusing on the negative first.
Okay, so say you're now looking at answer choice E. What happens? Describe what goes through your head, or what process are you employing?
I get to the word moral and I knock out the answer choice. This is nothing about morality at all, right? Like, okay. People, like, that's them trying to imply your outside knowledge, right? Where you, like, someone who has like a medical background, right, might like sort of recognize a moral issue here between like giving subjects incorrect medicine or medicine that doesn't work and testing new things, right? But I just tell, like, there's nothing moral here, so I'm done with it. I would not even read the rest of the sentence, honestly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And at this point, would you go back to the stimulus and read it again, or would you just move on to the next answer choice?
Just move on to the next answer choice here. I don't need to double check E, because like rereading it doesn't prove E wrong, right? Understanding the bounds of the argument is what proves E wrong. And I understand that like the bounds of this argument don't go to moral issues. Yeah. Depends on like what type of why I'm basically just depends on why I'm eliminating the answer choice. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
It takes for granted that most test subjects do not change their attitude towards the chance of it taking ineffective substances once the substance they take turns out to be ineffective. It's definitely not doing that, right? Like, this is not something it's assuming. Well, not change their attitude. But it's only representing ineffective substances. Well, that includes placebos. D is complicated, and it's hitting the right areas, right? Which is about attitudes of the test subject. Right? Mm-hmm. Accepting something at the beginning versus resenting something after. So it's really like hitting the argument points I want it to hit. I'm going to hold on to it. I can't spot anything obviously wrong. And I just move on and see if I can eliminate everything else. I'm done with D for now. I'm not going to try to force myself to prove it right. I'm just saying I can't find a reason yet to get rid of it. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, this is obviously not a sample that is likely to be unrepresentative because it's the exact same group of people both times, right? Well, not necessarily, but it's clearly like the right group of people. There may be like an argument about sample size because we don't know the sample size here, but it definitely is a representative sample, right? It's subjects in test of experimental medicines, and our final conclusion is about subjects in test of experimental medicine. Yeah. I over-explained that. I would eliminate that in less than 10 seconds, I would say.
What about the qualification? Subjects suffering from diseases from which they are already suffering. Would you just treat this as a trap or as some sort of distraction, or would you just completely ignore this qualification?
I mean, I don't think the qualification of being in tests designed to treat the diseases that they're suffering from is a qualification at all. In fact, it's almost redundancy. Like, people don't sign up to test experimental medicines unless they're like sick with the medicine. Why would the researchers want them in the trial, right? It's like, how can I tell if this is effective if you don't even have the disease to begin with? I don't think that's a meaningful qualification here. But thank you for pointing it out, because I hadn't thought much about it, right? Like, I think my brain made that decision internally. I didn't reflect consciously on why I ignored this as a conditional. I think it's surpluses at the end of the day. It's like a head fake by them.
Right.
That's a good move by them.
Yeah, I thought it might be... So this is where I got wrong, because when I was reading this, I also was tripped up. And okay. I thought maybe the study could get at issues such as prevention. If you want to do a medical study about preventing the onset of illnesses, you can also test certain behaviors to bring it about that illnesses don't even arise.
Yeah, right.
But so I do get the point.
Predisposition is something they, for some reason, yeah. So they take proactive action to prevent it over time. Yeah.
Right. But I think you're exactly right that in medicines, it would actually make sense to anticipate people at being sick. If they're perfectly healthy, it would. Yeah. There would need to be some sort of additional assumption as to why they're participating in the study to begin with.
Yeah. And in this context, this is one of those weird uses of suffering, right? Suffering usually implies like significant negative affect. But in the medical context, it's often used to just be they have this disease, right? It's not, it's open-ended as to the level of suffering they have from the disease. It's just like a catch-all for like that person has the disease. I think that would have like made sense too, but we're using sort of like a mini colloquial usage here for the medical context. That like, I don't know, I think a lot of native speakers would get, but it's much harder to grab if you're not a native speaker.
The notion of suffering?
Yeah, so I think suffering in this context would encompass prevention. Right, because they still have the disease, or they have like a disposition towards the disease. I don't know, but yeah, I agree that that's like not the main point, sort of. Yeah.
Okay.
Let's look at B.
Wait a minute. At this point, did you already read the stimulus a second time, or say, like in E, you were perfectly sure. In D, you kind of held on to the answer choice a particular candidate, and then you went on to C. Did you do some sort of rereading already, or at this point are we just moving through the answer choices, ruling out things that are obviously false?
Ruling things that are obviously false. I almost looked back for D, but again, like my decision usually is this seems in the right area. There's no obvious flaw. I'm just going to skip and come back, right? So I did not look back at D. Although I will say, if D is the right answer, you saw me almost eliminate it, but then changed my mind as I was rereading it one more time.
So you're rereading the answer choices.
Yeah. Yeah. When I, E and C, I would say I didn't really reread. But anything that's like expressing complex relationships, I usually take the time to reread. Especially as I'm knocking it out, right? As I'm knocking it out, I read it one last time to confirm I understand the contours. And here I change my mind because I like re-recognize the change in attitude. And I was like, oh, that's very on point for what I was looking for, right? Mm-hmm. I was trying to get between like the differences and accepting a risk and then later resenting it. Yeah.
Okay.
So I look at B, I'm just done with it immediately, right? We never talk about the scientific value of placebos. We talk about subjects resenting being given them, right? But no one here is opining on whether, like, there's value to placebos. So we can just get rid of that.
And B almost seems like a sort of ad hominem attack against these ethicists. It's saying people are not qualified to judge the experiment.
But the key for me is that opinions of people who are unlikely to be qualified, right? I think they're referring back to the test subjects themselves are making judgments about the value of placebos, but they're not. They're just resenting being given one. Yeah. Okay. And finally, A. Where is the two phenomena are associated? Any instances in which both phenomena are present? That's definitely not what's going on here. Well, I don't think, like, I don't, this word associated is what really stands out to me as making this wrong, right? The phenomena is accepting the risk and then resent afterwards. But again, I don't think, like, the goal here or what the flaw is inferring the two are associated. In fact, this is, like, A, I think in this instance is, like, we're talking about evidentiary arguments, right? And so, like, I don't know. If there are many incidences, like, this is not a terrible inference, right? It can be a, like, flaw, but it can also be something that's relatively justified, right? And so if it's, like, every time these experiments happen, right, afterwards the subjects are resentful, right? Like, that's a good inference based on the evidence in front of you. But at the end of the day, like, this doesn't feel like the flaw here, because I'm not getting that difference between attitude and acceptance.
Right, so A seems to say there's not even a correlation, or we cannot infer that there's a correlation. They're just isolated, many isolated cases. And that seems to be off.
Yeah, that doesn't mesh with what they're describing in terms of, like, these experimental consent forms. Let's go back to D. That's what I would do here. I'm just going to go back to D. Once we grant that most sense subjects do not change their attitudes once the substances they take turn out effective. Yeah, right. We're casting doubt. One second. We're not trying to cast doubt on the medical ethicist claim. We're trying to cast doubt. We're trying to find the vulnerability in the calmness claim. This cast doubt on the claim that many test subjects. Yeah, okay. That's exactly what we needed. Right? It's assuming that, like, these, like, this later observations must be incorrect because of the earlier observation that they accept the risk, right? So it's like what you see, medical ethicists, right? Or what you're implying here is incorrect because these people accepted it, therefore they must not resent it afterwards. Yeah.
Right, so there's a divergence in temporal markers. The first sentence has prior to, and then the second sentence has they turn out to be. Mm-hmm. And implicit in this is this shift between two moments in time.
Yeah. Just like you saw in my conclusion features before I had sequencing, right? The same for argument, right? But I write timelining, I think, for argument.
Yeah.
I hope D's right. I'm assuming.
Yeah, it is right. Like I had chosen C for this wrong treatment of the of people who are suffering from diseases that they already have.
Yeah. Overeating it to some degree.
Yeah. And I think sometimes I make these mistakes of overlooking things that only seem to be mentioned in passing. They're hidden. And on other occasions, I assign importance to things that are actually just context, but that don't really matter all that much. And I think what you are doing different than me is that you work more with anticipation. You already had this clear grasp of fact versus attitude as you went into the questions.
Yeah, I think that's why I have this very elimination-focused approach, right? I think a lot before I get to the questions, and then I have that clear idea, and it allows me to knock out answer choices much more quickly. Yeah.
Right.
So it's just like a difference in habits, although I constantly recommend my method, which is, you think about almost any, like, meaningful, long-term, or important activity in life, doing a little setup beforehand usually helps you to perform better, right? Like running in there half-cocked with no plan doesn't accomplish a lot, right? And I feel to some degree a lot of students do that. They just, they read the paragraph and then just jump in and they don't have a clear idea of what they're looking for. They don't have a clear idea of what has to be wrong. And so it's harder for them to spot those like the sharp differences between those two. Whereas I probably spend 30 seconds more on the prompt than almost all, like a lot of students. And I think that helps me a lot. I think it would help most students a lot, most people a lot. Same on logic games, right? I probably spend more on setups than almost anybody I know, even though, like maybe people who do worlds like you, I don't spend as much time on setups, but for people that do it my way, I still spend more time on setups than anyone. And same for reading comp too, right? You'll see like if you saw other students that were just doing normal reading comp, I read faster than them. I'm certain of that, but I reread each paragraph like 2 times as I'm reading it in order to take my notes. Yeah.
Interesting.
I try to really digest the paragraph and then I take 5 to 15 words in notes, right? And I think the other thing that does is each word of that note springboards my memory, right? Mm-hmm. It like explodes into an entire sentence and I remember the entire sentence or the context. But again, it's like that upfront investment and then I blaze through questions. Yeah.
Yeah. So for LR, presumably the thing to get really good at would be this pattern recognition of these differences between fact and attitude, sufficiency, necessity, part or will, things like that.
Yeah. Well, and I can show that argument features thing again.
Yeah. How,
like these are the things that are happening in my head, what I like notice about things as I do them, right? A causes B, A and B are correlated. We observed a phenomena, but we don't know if there's a correlation, right? So that would be like usually 1 or 2 observations, but not enough observations to give us a correlation. I'm still building this out, obviously. But then, like, same thing here, right? I broke this talk down into just, like, what made sense bit by bit, right? There's survey evidence, right? let me go through it. We have survey evidence in the first one. We have quantifiers, but I would have written down quantifier, and I'd cross it out because it doesn't matter here. I would write timeline, right, for the conclusion. Because it involves, right, before and after. I would probably write conflict. Where is it? Other people's implied. That wouldn't be other people's implied belief. Yeah, I would maybe say, like, other person's conclusion. Right? Because that, like, really we're rejecting that and explaining what specifically we're rejecting. But yeah. These things happen. Like I've been like trying to decompose what I see and what matters to me as I'm reading. And you know, I'm gonna keep working on that and hopefully build this up into something that's more useful for students.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you in any way specifically train you for these sorts of meta patterns to look out for? Like say, did you write any flashcards just listing the types of things that you're supposed to look out for, or do you just did you just internalize this automatically by doing so much LR?
Right. I think part of it goes back to like my big passion, I think, has always been human irrationality. Right. I was behavioral economics focused in college. I got a double major in econ and psych. So, right. I thought a lot about human decision making before this, before I took the test the first time. I'd taken a class on just pure critical thinking. I'd taken another class on fundamentals of formal logic, or I think it was just called fundamentals of logic. So I guess I had all of this stuff in my head already. And now, like, post-law career, like, I think I have it even more clearly in my head. just based on like different types of arguments made in law. Yeah. But I guess my answer is it comes from everywhere. I didn't use flashcards. It wasn't sort of a very deliberate thing, other than mm-hmm. me really liking this topic area and investing a lot of time in it. Yeah, I think that's the best like description.
Okay.
Yeah. Did I switch the people so they can see? Oh, that's right. The viewers can see both at the same time.
Yeah, I can see this. The browser window now.
Yeah. For them, I figured out how to add two browser windows at once to the Twitch. That way they can see both of these at once. So in that sense, they're actually getting a better deal than you know, funnily enough.
Yeah.
Okay.
I keep thinking about what I could do better in terms of more attentive reading. And it's sort of anticipation aspect seems to be one side of it. Like I have a clear overview of the patterns to look out for.
Yeah. And that also like to spend, you have flaw questions, right? Survey evidence, like inaccurate, inappropriate sample or unrepresentative sample, right? You know, each feature introduces potential flaws, right? Like insufficient sample size and unrepresentative sample are very particular to survey evidence. If you don't see survey evidence, those answer choices can't possibly be right.
Yeah.
Right, population groupings, maybe it's a false comparison, right? Maybe there's a shift in scope. I don't know, quantifiers, right? Easy flaws that the quantifiers don't add up, right? If it's an if-then argument, like the issue is probably going to relate to or will often relate to the sufficient necessary issue and usually like a broken contrapositive, right? Cost benefit analysis, right? Like maybe they're measuring it wrong. Maybe they're ignoring a third thing that needs to be included in the cost benefit, right? Each feature introduces its own specific flaw types, and that's the things to check for as you read through. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Multiple causes, right? Like maybe they're allocating the causation incorrectly. One thing is actually more important than the other, right?
Yeah. Flaws. Yeah. The flaws actually seem perhaps the most easiest or one of the easiest question types to anticipate.
Yeah. Once you see the features, it's usually like you just have a checklist at that point. You see these three features, you have seven things to check. And almost always one of those things is going to be the thing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe work with Dragon. Maybe get this added to his book. They're getting it, yeah. Part of those royalties. All right. Should we move on and do another LR question like I just did that one?
Sure. Can you select one question that you would like me to do and then I'll try to implement or like describe my reasoning process? Maybe you notice something that you find imperfect.
I love that. Let's do that. So you've done this one before.
Yeah.
But you don't want to use, well, obviously we don't want to use a full PP. Are there like LR sessions from earlier PPs that you never did?
Like I did most of them.
Okay.
I didn't
do
them.
Something from 64 then.
Can we choose one?
Sorry, go ahead.
Actually, let me check whether I did 64. I really want to keep the ones untouched that I haven't taken yet, but 64 might be one. I think I might have done this before. Yeah, I did this but a couple of months ago. So, okay, yeah,
perfect.
64 is fine.
If you recognize it, just based on overall. I have to end at 15 after today, by the way,
okay.
Just because I need to walk my dog and then take, and I'm teaching another thing at at the next look at it.
Okay.
But yeah. Yes. So we'll run maybe just like to a full 1.5 hours next week. Does that work?
Okay.
All right. Reminder to everyone watching that Clemens gets a discounted price and he's only paying for 1 hour, even though we always do 1.5 hours. Good to you too. Enough advertising, sorry. Okay. This is not the one. That one's really good. I love argument structure questions too. I just can't remember the difficulty level. Frankly, Chris is stupid. I don't want to do an if then because that's very different than what we just did. Have you done the heavy metal sludge one?
I don't remember.
This was one of the hardest ones from this exam, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, let's do this one.
Do you want me to look up the question, or are you showing it on the screen?
Oh my god, I'm showing the wrong screen. I'm sorry. Oh. Forgot to switch. I was like switching on Zoom, and then also switching on Twitch. It's confused sometimes.
Okay, so let me describe my process, basically reversing what we just did the other way around. Okay. So I'm also going to the stimulus. I see most strengthens, so I know it is a strengthen question. And then I go to, or I went to the question stem, and then I go to the stimulus.
Okay.
Okay. I notice immediately that there's a causal phrase in the first word, so probably we're doing some sort of causal reasoning. Because heavy metals are normally concentrated in sludge during the sewage treatment process. And then effect, the bacteria that survive have evolved the unusual ability to resist heavy metal poisoning. So the concentration of the heavy metals is presented as the reason why they have this resistance to poisoning. The same bacteria also show a strong resistance to antibiotics. So first we get a causal statement, and then now we get a correlation. The first statement identifies the exposure to heavy metals as the cause for the resistance. And now we get another correlation. They don't only have the resistance against heavy metals, but also against antibiotics.
Mm-hmm.
Then inference. This suggests the bacteria's exposure to the heavy metals and the sewage sludge has somehow promoted their resistance to antibiotics. So again, in itself, this seems not obvious. Just because the heavy metals have caused the resistance to heavy metals, it's not clear that the exposure to heavy metals would also bring about or cause the resistance to antibiotics. So if this was a weakening question, we could say, hey, perhaps the sewage also includes other, like another causally active agent. And since it's supposed to be a strengthened question, I would assume that we have to block this objection. Mm-hmm. We'd have to show it's not the case that the bacteria got this resilience from some other cause.
Okay.
And I'm basically reading the response, but I'm maybe different than you in my reading in that I look out for these causal statements. So I notice the because. I think that's relevant.
Okay.
And then also show the second sentence is much weaker. It just indicates a correlation, whereas the first indicated a causation. And then the author tries to infer that there's a particular causal relationship that explains this correlation. And what we would be trying to do at this point, I presume, is to block the introduction of alternative causes or alternative construals of the causal relationship.
I agree. And you got a good grasp? Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I have no comments so far.
Yeah. I don't have a particular order in which I go through these answer choices, but I'll... Yeah.
Follow your normal process. So... Yeah.
Okay, so I would basically... I know, choose them at random to just not have any order, say.
Okay, I like that too.
Like this is, I notice also that this is a question late in the section. So there, like in the very first question, the answer is often A or B. And at the very end, they tend to be more distributed to like the later choices.
Okay, so I just confirmed, I pulled open my, from October 2011, this is one of the two LR questions I missed.
Okay. Yeah,
this one is one of the two.
Yeah. So I'm going with A, just because I want to have this random approach. Okay. Most bacteria that are not resistant to antibiotics are not resistant to heavy metal poisoning either. I'm really not convinced by this. This seems to be like a set approach. And it's talking about a set we are not considering. We are considering the set of bacteria that are resistant, and this is talking about the set of bacteria that isn't resistant. Okay. So this seems to be talking about the wrong population. So,
okay. I think that works.
Okay.
I have another thought process here, but I'll save it for later once we finish.
Okay. Then I would go to E. Okay. Many kinds, many... being indefinite, they're resistant to both. But again, it's about a different type of bacteria, it seems. It's about bacteria that do not live in the sewage. And we are considering bacteria that are in the sewage. So it seems to be the wrong kind of bacteria.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. That's that one out, yeah.
Then... let's go to B. Okay. Bacteria that live in sewage sludge that is free of heavy metals are generally resistant to neither. So this is getting at an absence of the cause, but this seems to weaken rather. I'm not sure. It seems like the strengthen would have to block an alternative explanation, and this rather seems to get at the weakening of the causal relationship that we already observe. Oh no, it seems to confirm the heavy metal is really the cause. Yeah, if the heavy metals are not there, they're also not resistant to it. So it seems to confirm that heavy metal indeed is a cause for resilience to heavy metal. So I would get B out of the way because it just seems to confirm the relation. Okay, get rid of the.
Okay.
And I would go to D, sewage sludge that contains high concentrations. Uh-huh. I think I confused myself. Okay. This would seem to get like at the weakening. This would seem to suggest there's an alternative cause, and that's precisely what we don't want to have.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm confused. Like, I think I got confused with my anticipation. I wanted to block an alternative cause. D seems to provide an alternative cause. So D now seems to be the weakening answer. So D kind of doesn't show what I was looking for. Yeah, I think D is wrong. But okay. Not questioning my reasoning about the other answer choices. So the bacteria exposure to the heavy metals has promoted the resistance to antibiotics. So trying to argue resilience to heavy metal increases resilience to antibiotics.
Okay.
I think D is also wrong. C is also wrong because it goes in the wrong direction. It says contributes to the resistance in heavy metal poisoning. And we want to have something to the effect of Resistance to heavy metal poisoning contributes to resistance to antibiotics. Okay. I made a mistake somewhere. This picture is...
I think the statement you just made was a mistake.
Huh. Antibiotics.
Is it their heavy metal resistance that has to contribute to their antibiotic resistance?
Huh. So it goes somehow in the other direction. Antibiotic resistance.
It's not that one resistance has to contribute to the other, it's that heavy metals is contributing to the antibiotic resistance.
Okay. So the exposure to heavy metals causes the resistance to antibiotics. Yeah, but C does seem to, the causal relationship in C seems different from the stimulus.
Okay.
In the stimulus you get, the exposure to heavy metal causes resistance to antibiotics. And C seems to say antibiotic resistance causes resistance to heavy metal. I think I got myself in a corner. I think I'm getting this wrong. Yeah, so D, I'm going back to D again because D also seems to intuitively make sense. There's a correlation. But it introduces this alternative cause. It's saying it's not the exposure to heavy metals that contributed to the resistance. It's rather the exposure to antibiotics that causes the resistance to antibiotics. So C seems wrong.
I agree. C is definitely wrong. It's super tempting, but it's definitely wrong.
Yeah. Can we make D yellow? Like just highlight the whole answer choice? Then. For me, this is like a sign that it's completely wrong and that I won't look at it again.
Okay.
Okay.
That's a good idea.
E also seems completely wrong. So I would now go through these answer choices again and do a sort of second check. So E seems to, E just targets the wrong population. Can we make E yellow?
Okay. I can hide them and make them black.
Yeah. A also seems completely wrong. So it must. So by elimination, I'm getting back to C again, but I don't really see the antibiotic resistance.
I'll cheat and intervene a little bit. One of these two is the right answer, and one of these two is the wrong answer that I chose. So, you're definitely down to the right two.
I'm going back to the stimulus. We have this causal relation. The heavy metals are the cause of the resilience to heavy metal poisoning. So heavy metal causes resilience. And then the effect of resilience also occurs in the case of antibiotics. So if you could show that resilience to heavy metal causes resilience to antibiotics, that would be ideal. The author is trying to argue that exposure to heavy metals causes resistance to antibiotics.
three of heavy metals, but it's not.
I didn't mean to do that.
Wait a minute.
That was unintentional. That wasn't meant to be a hint or anything. Go ahead.
I think B is getting at the issue of presence and absence, of course, and we're trying to strengthen. And B is arguing if there is no heavy metal.
Yeah.
I think it's B, because B is, it's like this dioxin question. If the cause is absent, the effect is also absent. So this makes it more likely that the heavy metals are indeed the cause. I think it's B. Is it right? No?
So you chose what I did on the test. I chose B. The answer is C.
It survives and such.
So I think the issue that I had then and that you, I was observing you have right now, is you kept coming back to heavy metal resistance leads to antibiotic resistance. But all we need to prove is that exposure to the heavy metals leads to antibiotic resistance. So C says that if the bacteria is in sewage sludge, increasing their antibiotic resistance in turn increases their heavy metal resistance or the resistance to heavy metal poisoning, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, that would give us a clear reason why being in that environment causes increased resistance to antibiotics. And it's not because the antibiotic resistance has value in and of itself, it just has value in preventing heavy metal poisoning. Yeah, very complex, weird answer choice, because it like makes you think about like drawing the causation arrow in the opposite way you think you should be drawing it. And that's what I heard when you were reviewing it, right? It's that like this, like it needs to go the other direction, the arrow, but in this case it doesn't actually need to. Yeah. And then I think the issue with B, right, is but that still doesn't tell us if there's another reason heavy metal sewage, whether the bacteria in heavy metal sewage would develop antibiotic resistance, right? Knowing that ones that don't live in this environment have neither like thing still doesn't give us that causation sort of indication.
So we're trying to argue it's not resistance to heavy metal that it causes resistance to antibiotics. We're trying to argue it's exposure to heavy metal.
Yeah.
That brings about. So C is saying the exposure to heavy metal.
Right, there's an independent reason, like there's a clear reason why these bacteria would develop antibiotic resistance, and that's because it helps them not have heavy metal poisoning. Reason I missed it.
Yeah, you know, I'm more confused.
Let me do a little paint thing.
So C is saying the cause of the resistance to heavy metal is the resistance to antibiotics. So exposure to heavy metal.
No. It's just antibiotics helps prevent heavy metal poisoning. It's kind of saying that neither of the two things are causing each other. It's that both provide sort of independent resistance to heavy metal poisoning, which is what we're trying to prevent. Or what these are trying to avoid. Where's the type? I don't know how to use this. That's annoying. But yeah, okay. But I think like the concept here is that exposure to heavy, like the bacteria have survived to resist heavy metal poisoning, right? Mm-hmm. The exposure to heavy elements creates the risk. Heavy metal resistance is one way the bacteria resist a heavy metal poisoning. C is saying that antibiotic resistance in it of itself also contributes to their resistance to heavy metal poisoning.
Mm.
Right? And so that gives a clear reason why being in the heavy metal environment would cause them to develop high antibiotic resistance.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know, this is a wild one.
Yeah, so I did reasonably well in the exclusion of wrong answer choices, but then chose the wrong one.
Yeah. Oh. I wonder what the correct answer like rate is on this one. I should check. Here, if I submit this, so I can't remember if they have that.
You can look it up. It's 64. Which section is this? 64.3.
Yeah, that was 64. Wait, what? Wait, B is the correct answer, not C. Wait, what?
So I had it right.
What are we talking about here? Your response, B. Okay, on my official results, I wrote B, and it was marked as incorrect. And the credited response was C. Do I have a 180? Did this just prove I have a 180? This can't be right.
Let me look it up.
Yeah, check another website.
So 64.3.
Have I had a 180 this entire fucking time because they misgraded something? Son of a bit. There's no way. There's no possible way.
64.3.
22. Hmm. I'm doing things. So.
Yeah, on 7th stage, the answer is B. I think your test might have gotten misdiagnosed or something.
What? What? I have a 180? Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, maybe you can.
Fuckers. I could have gotten into like fucking Harvard, Yale, Stanford with a 180.
Maybe you can appeal it somehow.
Yeah, I'll show it to you. Stop it. No, I'm doing things.
Yeah.
My cat is attacking me from behind the chair.
But this is satisfying to me also because it shows that my actual reasoning is not as flawed as I thought it is. Because I think B is much more straightforward. It shows if the cause is absent, or if the presumed cause is absent, the presumed effect is also absent, which strengthens the idea that this thing is really a cause.
You can see it, right? My response was B. The credited response was C. Right here.
Yeah, I think. Is it the right section?
Section 322. Uh-huh. We were at section 3, right?
I think it's section 1.
I thought I was in like section 3.
On 7th stage, this shows up as section 1. And there you have the B. So this might be a question you actually got right.
Oh, motherfucker. Okay. That was the one I got wrong.
The one you got wrong? Might have gotten wrong section 322, which is most strongly supported. And that the answer is C.
Okay, let me just look at that way.
So I think the question you got wrong is scientists' astounding success rate.
Well, shit. Okay, that's disappointing. It's also sad that you guys don't get these anymore. Like a full like list of your responses and where you missed. Right, that way when the actual test comes out, like the actual test is released, you can check your stuff.
Yeah, this actually seems very helpful.
Yeah. Yeah, no, they get like this is just the big score report thing. Yeah. And then I just looked and apparently I did not miss 2 LR. I actually missed 1 RC pretty early on. Question 10, I think. And then I missed 1 logic games as well. Very disappointing as well. All right. Well, I'm sorry for misleading you on the previous line.
Don't worry about it.
You can also see like the influence of me thinking I know the correct answer. Did I convince you that C was better?
No, I was just getting more confused. But I thought it was my fault. Like I thought you were right and I just didn't get something.
Yeah, speaking from a position of authority, right? But I was indeed wrong and you're right and I'm sorry about that. Jesus, sorry. It was like, I can't believe I like forgot which section we were in. Yeah. Okay. How are you feeling at the end of the day or of today?
You think I need to practice these very straightforward, simple things, just like reading correctly and paying attention to stuff? This sounds incredibly trivial, but this is, I think, the cause where I still go wrong most of the time. Like when I make still mistakes, the cause of that is most likely imperfect reading habits and imperfections in attention.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, obviously your 2 logic games misses were exactly that. Like, see, like they're 100% that, and to some degree, all of these were that a little bit. Yeah, I think.
So I'll try to reduce that.
Yeah, keep doing the self-observation of your process and think about where you could buff up your double-checking without costing you too much time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of any last things. I'll try to publish an early version of that thing. So if you want to look at that more while you're going back through this stuff, definitely.
Sure. If you send me a draft or something, I can proofread it and then try to see if there's anything that comes up.
Yeah, I think, that makes sense. I don't think I'm doing anything complex with it in terms of formatting. So I'll just copy it into Google Docs and then send you a link.
All right.
Okay.
Done. Thanks.
Of course. All right. See you next week.
Bye.
And we're done. I hope you enjoyed it, and post the pod later. And got to see me look dumb for a little bit. Okay. Bye-bye, guys.